take my hand, hold it tight. I will protect you from all around me. I will be here, don't you cry.
Early phases of the corporation began with the land corporations such as the Virginia Company, the Plymouth Company, and the Dutch West India Company. The general attitude of Europe at the time was that land was a commodity to be freely bought and sold for financial profit by individual entrepreneurs. From the time that the settlers landed in North America, they had difficulty understanding the beauty of the continent. The settlers only viewed the resources of the earth as property. Land was for settlement and possession. Soil was for cultivation. Forests were for timber. Rivers were for travel, for irrigation of fields, and for power. Animals such as the wolf, the bear, and the snake were for killing. The beaver, the deer, and the rabbit were for the fur or the food that they could provide. The settlers did not need the land for spiritual understanding and to convey a sense of the sacred. At the time, the settlers only needed the land for the progress and development.
The second phase of the corporation in America is known as the Canal and Railroad Phase. The canal phase began in 1817 when New York State decided to build a canal 363 miles long from the Hudson River to Lake Erie. This project was completed in 1825. Projects such as this were carried out by corporations, chartered by states, and given rights of eminent domain, a right justified due to the public benefit that comes from it. The success of the Erie Canal led to the construction of many more canals joining the Atlantic side of the Appalachian Mountains to the interior parts of the continent. Around 1850, railroads began to take over transportation activity of the country. The government granted millions of acres of land to corporations to fund the railroads. Those who founded and controlled the corporations that built the railroads throughout the country made fortunes. The railroads ultimately made the continent available for intensive industrial and commercial development.
The third phase began after the Civil War and was the most formative phase in the modern corporation. It was the beginning of oil, electrical, and automotive industries. During this time, two significant movements were occurring. The first, the early awareness of the harm being done to the natural world by the new industries and technology, which led to the beginning of the conservation movement. The second, the social protest against the exploitation of the working people who did the difficult and dangerous jobs associated with the industrial world. This was a harsh phase where natural selection and Darwin's theory, survival of the fittest, determined people's jobs and lives. The industrial world controlled American society, and the corporations had the power to resist regulations by the government. Because of this, they were able to prosper through legal and illegal use of public funds and public properties, which ultimately led to the destruction of forests, rivers, mountains, and other natural ecosystems. This phase was the beginning of a horrific destruction of our natural world.
The fourth phase of the corporation began with the ending of World War II in 1945. Three terms evolved from this era to describe the work of the corporations in the United States: corporate libertarianism, corporate welfare, and corporate colonialism. First, the term corporate libertarianism refers to the instance of corporations to carry on their work as they see best. This lack of adequate controls over the corporations allows them to use the resources of the continent to extract benefit and leave the waste disposal problem as a public responsibility. When they are later required to clean up their residue, they insist that it is the responsibility of the government. Corporate welfare means that the government best serves its people and the well-being of society by using public resources to support the industrial and commercial corporations. This led to minimal regulation and the exponential development of corporations and their impact on the environment. Third but not least, corporate colonialism refers to the trend of corporations to extend their power over weaker people or nations. This expansion of corporate influence increased the corporation's power, and until recently, little consideration was given to the disastrous effects that these establishments were having on the life systems of the planet.
The fifth phase is meant for us to realize we must act now for the future of Earth. The previous eras have described the survival of the fittest theory as if it were meant for corporations. If corporations and CEOs of massive industries do not develop a better communion between their business and the wildlife of Earth, our future and destiny as humans is surely to follow negatively. Our continuous destruction without anything rebuilt will be the cause of our further demise on Earth, erasing everything humans built as a growing species. We have not been feeding the world, but starving it and taking from it.